おかしいておりますので、ご紹介いただきたいと思います。改めまして皆さんこんばんは。お足元の悪い中、お越しいただきありがとうございます。本日は、ジョン・ミッテゾークさんの、来日特別公演ということで、ご予約いただいてありがとうございました。まず、本日、司会進行を務めさせていただきます、中島と申します。よろしくお願いします。まず自分の方から簡単に、今日のイベントの流れと、あとお手元に配布してあります資料のことを軽く説明させていただきます。まず、本日の流れですが、この後、坂下さんの方から挨拶と、あとジョンの紹介をしていただいて、ジョンの、スライドショーに移っていきます。その後、ジョンのスライドショーが終わった後に休憩を1回挟みます。まあ、10分程度と考えております。その10分程度の休憩の後に、坂下さんとジョン、まあ、場合によっては南浦さんも入っていただいて、A5 という概念、これは、まあ、エイドクライミングのグレードというふうに言われていますけれども、その A5 という概念について、それと、岩と向き合う態度そのものについてのお話を伺っていきたいと思います。はい、その後時間を見てですけれども、軽く、質疑応答等できればと思っております。はい、進行については以上です。ではお手元の資料、2つお配りしています。一つ、日本語で書いてある資料の方、本日先に申し上げておくと、ジョンのスライドショーには通訳はつけません。通訳を入れてしまうと、2人に話していただく時間がどんどん減ってしまいますので、基本的には通訳は入れずにスライドショーは一気に見ていただくという形になっております。ですので、その内容のあらすじというかアウトラインの部分だけを日本語で書き起こしましたので、まあ、そちらも参照しながら見ていただければと思います。はい、もう一つの、英語で書かれている資料、そちらは、彼がジョン・ロームというクライマーと共著で出されている、How to Rock Climb というシリーズのビッグウォールズという本の抜き刷りになります。この抜き刷りの部分には何が書かれているかというと、まあ、後々お話しします A5 というグレードを含むグレード体系と、そのまあ、それが何に基づいているかという哲学のを書いてあります。こちらは英語で書かれていますので、またご興味のある方、持って帰って頑張って読んでいただければと思います。はい、それでは長くなりましたが早速始めていきたいと思います。では坂下さん、よろしくお願いします。
今日はどうもお集まりいただきましてありがとうございます。まあ、ドームとは1994年ぐらいからその A5、 彼がやっていたビッグオーヨーのクライミングギアを作っている会社で、まあ、それを販売したんですけども、私どもが輸入することになって、だいたい 4、5 年だったと思います。輸入してて、ただ A5 そのものはノースフェイスに買収されましたので、その後は実は製品をしてないんですけど、だから5年ぐらいの付き合いだったんですね。でそれが2年半ぐらい前に突然メールが来まして、で日本で1920年代ぐらいに作られていた金のロープに関してちょっと教えてほしいと。1920年っつったら俺が生まれる何十年前だってちょっと思ったんですけれども、で私もその何人かから聞いて、で彼の方からなんか牧犬坊さんたちがアルバータに行く時とかなんかその頃に開発したんじゃないかっていうメールが来たので、それで慶応の方からもいろいろ聞いたりなんかしたんですけれども、100周年慶応山岳部が創立して100周年の記念号っていうのが出て、それに牧さんたち その古い写真が載ってたので、それを彼に、まあ、送ったんですけど、そしたら彼がなんかそのビゴリオのクライミングの進化についてこんな熱い本を 去年出したんですね。でその中にそのマクサの話だとか慶応のアルバータの話だとかミッテルミニの話だとかそれから絹のロープだとかの話が載ってまして、それで偶然、彼が今度日本に息子さんと老園さんと一緒にスキーに行きたいっていうなんかメールが来たので、それでいい場所を教えてくれないかって言ったら、いやちょっとスキー行く前お前一日あのスキー場じゃないんだけどなんかちょっと面白いとこあるから一晩寄ってくれってここに強引に連れてきたわけなんです。でただまあ彼ともそんな古いこう長い付き合いじゃなかったんですけれども、今日一日3時間ぐらい一緒にいて飯食べたんですけど、いやなんかその物事に対しての突き詰め方とか突っ込んでいくこう深く掘り下げていく能力ってすごいなと思いました。まあそれはクライマーとしてのその A5 クライマーとしての突き詰め方、技術の突き詰め方もそうでしょうし、それからまあポーターレッジにしろ、まあいろんな A5 登るためのギアを開発したんですけれども、その研究の仕方だとか攻め方がなかなかすごいものがあって、多分今度 そのスライドショーでそれがちらっと垣間見えるといいかなと思います。で後で私の方からちょっと先ほど中島から紹介あったような質問を2つぐらいしていたいと思います。で彼の、まあ、クライミングに対する、まあ、エティックス倫理観だとか、それから A5 の持つグレードの凄さみたいなの、今日は石野さんだとか野中さんが、まあ、あの来られてますし、まあ、南浦さんと星名がいますんで A5 の世界っていうのは、まあ、何人かは知ってるかもしれないですけど、でも今スポーツクライミングあるいはフリークライミングをやってる人にもそのエッセンスみたいな、そのスピリッツみたいなのをできれば知ってほしいなと思ったんで今日に来てもらいました。じゃあ、あのいろんな写真が出てくると思いますけどよろしくお願いします。
It's very much a great honor to be here and to meet some of my heroes who have climbed the big mountains of the world. And I want to definitely thank Hoshina for arranging all this. And because originally I just got in touch with him because I wanted to find out some more history. And I found out about the Tango show and I was very excited to be able to come. And I thank you very much for inviting me to Tokyo to present and to meet all of you.
Thank you very much.
And so without further ado, I will begin. And this show is about climbing big walls, the big mountains, the big rock walls of the world. It's not working. So just a few slides on how I started climbing, because I started climbing in 1974, and climbing is much different today. So when I started climbing, here's me looking like, oh, this is hard, mountains. I was sent to a mountaineering school, and I was thrown out of my element. I didn't know if I liked it at first. It was a 5-week program, and very, very difficult for me as a 14-year-old. But when I discovered these big, I just love the long rock climbs, the big rock climbs I found, like, that was exactly what I loved. And so I went from, but this was during the age when pitons had been used, and then it was like, no more pitons. You can't use pitons because we climb clean. So this was the end of the piton days. And these were the only two books on how to rock climb back then. There was a book by Roe Robbins and a book by Warren Hardy, and very different ideas about how to climb. And but I read all these very carefully and was like, so Roe Robbins was all about clean climbing, and you know, we, not so much always good perfection, but whereas Warren Harding had a sort of different view about clean climbing. He's got the naked climber, no clothes, climbing very clean. How do you say that in English? So these were my influences of climbing. But also in 1974, a friend of Nari's, Dennis Hennick and Doug Robinson, they climbed Half Dome in Yosemite, all clean, no pitons. And that was very inspiring to us. Like, oh, you can climb now, you can climb big walls with no pitons. And so, I wanted to also learn that. And so I trained as a climber for 2 years and just got to be where I could climb a bit harder. And then in 1978, I climbed Half Dome all clean, and it was, I thought that was the end of, you know, the top of the climbing. Okay, I have climbed Half Dome, I'm okay. Now I can do something else. But I ended up liking climbing more and training more and getting stronger at school. And also learning how to ice climb. It was all, back then when you were climbing, you learned everything. You learned how to free climb, to hang climb, ice climb, mountain climb. Everything was part of the game. When I first went to Yosemite, I saw El Capitan, and then I knew, okay, that is for me. I need to climb El Capitan. And so I went to university, but after university, I sold all my climbing books, or sold all my books, education books. I bought a motorcycle, and I traveled to Yosemite. I show my motorcycle here because in Yosemite, I sold the motorcycle to two climbers from Japan, and they told me they were going to bring it back to Japan. It was an old beat-up motorcycle, and I always wonder if I ever made it to Japan. And I met this fellow, Warner Braun, and everybody who's been to Yosemite knows Warner, yeah. And he invited me to join the rescue team and to be part of the Yosemite, you know, the spirit of Yosemite. So I worked on the rescue team, and this is after a rescue. There's some articles about how we were helping to save climbers. And so I learned how, you know, I got better at climbing, by climbing. And I just love all being up in space. The big walls were what I loved, to just be up on these big walls, tiny, tiny person, and just love that geometry and the techniques and the using of all the tools to climb, you know, just that you're free climbing sometimes, and then sometimes you use these, but it was all about just being in the position up on the wall. Do you want to translate a little bit of that, or?
Oh, yes.
So the idea was to be up on the wall, you know, like we're, this place is hard to find and hard to get to, but that's what the spirit of it.
登ってくる最中でこう特にハングだとか水だとかいろいろその わからない部分をこう探って、その次の、オブジェクトでこう行く過程がすごくミステリアスで楽しかった。
And so, so I learned how, I realized that to do this, you need some pitons. So, okay, pitons are back. I'm going to use some pitons because that's, I want to climb the big roots. And over in the years I was in Yosemite, you know, I basically went from being totally scared to being, okay, I can climb this now, I'm confident, you know. So I learned how to use the tools to climb more physically and more confidently. And eventually I got to the point where I felt like I could climb a new route, a route that nobody had been up before. And I looked here and I saw that nobody had climbed up here. I thought, I can do that. I'm going to see how to climb. This is the North America. And then to the right of it, we called it the Atlantic Ocean Wall. And to do a route like that, you spend a lot of time studying. You look. And you study, and this I drew this map before we were still on the ground. We're just looking at binoculars and making the map. Because when you're on the wall, you might be here and there might be a good crack, but you can't see it because you can't see over around the corner. So you have to make a map before you go to know where you're gonna, you know, what's possible. And so you use the telescope. Binoculars and study. I think it was Edward Winter who said, "Only a fool goes up without a plan." You know, so this was about making a plan before.
ノーサメントモールの右側に誰も登ってないルートがここはあるなってんで、アトランティックオーシャンというルートを作ることにするんですけど、下から見てですね。これアトランティックオーシャンウォールトリールートトポワークみたいにあるんですけど、登る前に全部もうトポを作ってるんですね。で下から見て、まあ、そのある程度予想してるところもあるかもしれないし、想像してるところもあるかもしれないけど、トポをもうすでに作っちゃってるっていうのが彼のそのツッコミの鋭さとか、なんかガーッと入っていく能力の凄さをなんかこれも見せているような感じがします。
So, you know, this is very small, you know, and again, you have all this rock ahead. It's just like, you know, for the next week, you're going to be climbing, 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 climbing. And again, you know, you're using the tools, sometimes for climbing, but, you know, whatever is the most efficient way to climb.Because you might bring 7 days. I think we were up 7 days on this climb. So, but if this is all actually not there anymore. We climbed up here, and since then, and when we were up there too, it's like your climbing is like, crack, you hear the rock breaking, and maybe 2 years after we climbed it, I'll fall back. So, yeah, that's probably pretty clear. Right?you know, so you're going out on new climbing and you don't know, very scary sometimes because you don't know if this block is going to fall off or anything. So it's a very unique type of climbing when you're using the, you know, ape climbing. And this was a very difficult pitch here.At the time it was A5 because it was expanding. So if you put in a piton and they put in another, the plate expands. How do you say expanding? You know expanding as.
ちょっと分かりにくいかもしれませんけど、ストーンを打つと。で、そのクラックがこう打てばビーッと広がっていくんですね。 で、下に向かって細い場合は下に打ってそこに立ってて打つと自分のプンッと受けるんです。だからこっちに最初から取っておいて打たないとボンとしていって、それでまた次に打つとその打ったピトンがまたボンと抜けるんで。
So there is placement, all fell out, you know, as I kept going up. And then finally, okay, that one is not expanding. Good. But, and also the ledge here. So anytime I fell, bam! Oh, no, scary.
So フラットなその岩になってるんで、落ちたらそこにバチンとぶつかるんで、
and then,
落ちたくないんだけど。
And then here, you sometimes climb up and there's no more crack. And so, you, oh, okay, lower me, and you lower down, and then you run across to get another piece of climb. So that is a very difficult pendulum. So we call that a pendulum because you're running back and forth. And that's really fun.
Yeah,
so that's the kind of experience that you can get up on a big climb like that. But also free climbing, sometimes, oh, so it's okay for free climbing. Put the shoes on, and you know, much quicker and faster. Put the anchors away, we don't need these, and go for it, you know. So when you can, you free climb. And then this is right at the end, and you can see, you know, it's like not very good protection, but you're just trying to get up with using the tools. So it's about tools, really. And this is the hero shot. Okay, we climbed the roots and we show our hero shot. You know. I like to show my son this because he's very strong. I tell him I used to be strong. And so I was living in Yosemite, and I didn't really have a lot of money, but I was working the rescue team, and you can see, like, living week to week, so living on very minimal, you know, money. So, and this was like this was a 2-day very difficult rescue. You get $200, you know, for rescue. And it was a very sad rescue because there was two climbers who had died on the nose, and so we had to take them off too.
これはですね。1990年に、ローズを登ってて、もう一パーティーはパシフィックオーシャン登ってたんですけど、パシフィックオーシャン登ってたのは林さんと福原さん、それでローズを登ってたのは佐田さんという方と八橋さんという方が登ってて、ローズの最終ピッチでもうすごいもう抜けて簡単なところなんですけど、そんな乾いてればもう5分もあれば登れるところなんですけど、そこで吹雪になって彼は多分 T シャツ着てたと思うんですけど、あっという間に凍死したんですね。でその時に彼はレスキューチームにいて、まあ彼をそのレスキューしようとしたんですけど、その時4パーティーがいて、そのローズの最終ピッチにいるのは分かってたんですけども、多分最終ピッチなんで彼ら自力で抜け出るなと思って、そのレスキューがものすごい最後になったらしいんですね。で行ってみたら2人が亡くなってたっていう、まあ、ちょっと悲劇的な事件でしたけども、その時彼はそのレスキューでそのワンパーティー朝に240ドルのその賃金しかもらえなかったって言うんですか、すごい安い賃金らしいんですね。危ないことをまあすごく要求されるんですけど。
So rescue was one way, but also, you know, sometimes I would get in the Patagonia catalog, and you wouldn't get any money, but you would get free gear. So that was good because then we could have warm gear. So we got jackets and things like that. And then also the real way you could live in Yosemite was you, because you had the skills to climb walls, then you could rig. And so rigging and film work, that was enough to live for years there. And also bootleg guiding, so sometimes it can't be official, but okay, you know, you can take somebody up for a wall, and so that's how we made some money to live in Yosemite.
まあ、彼はスタンフォードを卒業して非常にこうあの優秀な学生で、まあ、あの家庭も非常にあの裕福な家庭だったらしいんですけど、なんか寄せ見てもうこれから 2,3 年入るっつったら、バカ野郎いい加減にしろって、お前には金一銭も送んないよって言われて、そのレスキューの仕事やったり、そのあとフィルムワークだとか、パタゴニア そのカタログの仕事だとか、まあ、こういうガイディングの仕事をしながら、寄せ見ての生活3年したみたいですけど、それで食ってたっていう話です。
Who recognizes this? Who has been to Yosemite and who knows where this is? Put your hand up if you know this crime. No, you know.
Bootleg を知ってる人、手を挙げてください。
Yes. Yes, oh good, yeah, Salate, yeah. So, very good crime. Now it all free, of course. And eventually, I was able to buy a van. Now the van had no motor, but I could sleep in the van, so that was nice. Oh, no, just the van. So, the next part of the show is my interest in portalettes, which is the hanging platforms for sleeping. So on big walls, very rare to find a flat place to sleep. You don't see this very often. Only maybe, you know, very mostly just hanging in space. And so we started using these submarine hammocks, but submarine ledges, but they were very heavy, 20 kilograms. And then you couldn't really carry them down, so when you got to the top, you would just throw them off and shoot down. Sometimes very dangerous.
初期のポータレンジは20キロあったんで、それ背負って帰るのは面倒くさいから、上から落としたら、ものすごい勢いでビュンビュンビュンビュン飛んでるって、下にいるやつはもうちょっと見えまくった。
You couldn't do that today.But you know, then Gramici came out with his portal edge in the late early 80s. So, and these were the portal edges that Minamura used and that Hoshino used on Trango in 1990. And so this was a very light portal edge, folds up, and so I bought one of those in my 1985. I started climbing with portal edges. Beautiful. Oh, suddenly, oh, you wake up. Yes, you can climb again instead of being all wrong. So portal edges changed the way you climb after each day. But then I decided I was going to climb the south face of Half Dome. And they call it Half Dome, but it's not really a half dome, it's a slice of a dome. Because this is the famous north face, but the south face is also very steep. So it's more like a slice. And we're going to do a route up this area here. And we started in nice sunny weather, beautiful, climbing. But soon it got very cold. And after a few days, a big storm came in and we were stuck. The ropes are frozen. No rappelling on those ropes. You can't even get them coiled up. So you're trapped on a wall in a situation like that. And so we decided to stay in our portal edges, but because of the wind and the storm, these portal edges were not built strong enough, and they just collapsed. And so we were huddled up in portal edges, and because there was so much snow coming down that they just broke. And that required us to get a rescue. So the hill got lucky because we were so grateful. They could come in and they lowered the guy down and they pulled us off the wall because, and it was only in a short window of time that the storm enabled the helicopter to come in. And right after we got pulled off, there was another big storm, we would have died for sure. So we were so grateful for the Navy helicopter.
なんかこれは予選艇のなんかクライミングシーンの中でも最も厳しいあの嵐が来たらしいんですね。その広島山の会の方が亡くなられた時も厳しかったんですけど、この時はなんかもっともっと激しいその雪が降り続いてですね、でものすごい寒波が来たので、彼らがもう6日間だったかな、7日間だったか、ここに閉じ込められて、でしかもボーダレージが壊れちゃったので、もうぶら下がって、なんか、まあ、本当はレスキューチームにいたんですけど、今度はレスキューされる側だったので、でも、レスキューされなかったら、多分死んでたんじゃないかっていう話です。
So, you know, this was a very lucky rescue, icy storm, newspapers. For me, it was like, okay. This was in Merced, local paper, Merced Times, yeah. You know, like...
Is it in October, November?
Oh, it was in, I think it was March or April.
March.
Yeah. And they had predicted good weather, but it was a freak storm. And so, after that, after shivering for so long, I moved to Arizona.
Good choice.
I said, don't worry, send me. I didn't even want to climb the big wall again. The big walls were too scary for me. And I went to Yosemite, or went to Arizona, and started climbing in the desert, much warmer. And this is my car at the time. And it was very important to have a rescue vehicle. So when you're driving on these dirt roads, if you get stuck, you have a bike, you can get back out. So,
あのポンコツの車だったんで、あのいざという時に自転車を積んでて、演出を起こしたら、この自転車で逃げるという。
I used it a lot, actually. At least three or four times, or otherwise, many days of walking out. And so, you know, just really exciting, just a new way of climbing that I discovered. It's just very interesting. So, this picture here is going through that hole there.And it was new to me to climb with all this geometry, and that's I liked the different type of climbing it was offering in the desert. And I also started to paraglide a bit because I think, as we know, you know, at the time these are for getting off walls. You climb a wall and then you take your parachute and you jump up, right? That's how we thought about it. And so I was practicing going to the edge of a cliff, okay, just jumping off like that. But
excuse me, is this a summit of memory store?
That's what I was thinking.
Yes.
But I also decided, okay, I'm going to start making equipment because the equipment I felt wasn't good enough for this kind of stuff. So it went from the sketch, to a company. So I started a company in Arizona, and this are a couple of our catalogs. And now I was one of our distributors in Japan, and it was exciting to start to.Design new gear. So, you know, nobody had made a hammer because it was all about clean climbing, but you need a hammer for these kind of walls. So I made a hammer and I got it all made up. This was the only climbing hammer that you could buy at the time. And I set up this shop, and the whole idea was to innovate. We've got to innovate new tools.For the big walls. This was our very technical shop where we tested fabric. So we dragged it across and decided, oh, okay, that's the kind of fabric. Very, very, very high tech. And also, I wanted to share the information about how to climb big walls. So I wrote articles about how to do it and made drawings of like the techniques of Bengal cricket. So, and I think you had a book or so I wrote some books on how to do it because nobody had really written any books on all the different ways of climbing. And so this was, we also did, our goal was to get people interested in these big routes. And so, just different new techniques of how to do it. And this is Aurora, right? You climbed Aurora? So this was the first time like putting all the roots on the page. And so this was a big idea. So to design a mirror, I would go up on the big walls and I would take notes. And these were all notes I made when I was up on a wall, like, oh, this could be better. And so I think that's the only way to innovate is to do and then also come back and design. So you can see this, it must have rained on that wall because my nose got wet. And then I come back to the shop and I, design new equipment. And also hardware, so I was involved with the hauling pulley. So this was because nobody had a pulley that had a cam in it. And so this was the very first one. And I worked with Rocket Zotica on that. And we did a solo device. And this I did that later, actually, a drill holder. But I was also working on different clean tools. And this was the first production hooking piton. So now there are many, many types of hooking pitons. But that, in 1988, that was the first one that had that feature. And then writing more techniques on how to climb. But of course, because of that half-dome experience, I really wanted to design a better portalage. So we started making new types of portalages, very strong and very weatherproof. Oh yeah, there's the beam. So that is actually one of our first ones from 1988. I can tell from the and so the portalages we're making were just very strong and still light and just quick deploy for the storm and basically sets up fast. So you're up on the wall, you're hanging, and you can just set up your legs. And so I was making them for well-known climbers who were doing the hardest climbs. So Mug Stump, he got one of our first portalages, and he did a new route in the Ruth Gorge, which was the portalage was a very important tool for his ascent of that. How would I say that? It was a critical tool, I guess, for that ascent. And I also supplied Silva Caro, and they climbed this incredible route up here, very early, 1987, I believe, big wall. And Catherine Desterville, I made her a very light one, a small one, a custom one, so she could solo the Drew. And and of course, our Sheena, it was on the shield with some A5 portalages that we had. So, it's fun to make the climbing, make the gear for the climbers who really need good tools. And, went to trade shows and maybe we're doing all the business stuff. And I had a big team of people who were helping. And this is now he was importing the A5 brand. So every year we very exciting, we get the order from Maui. 25 portalages, 5 haul bags. So that was always a big project for us to supply the biggest orders we had, really, you know, single orders. There's the beak. So, and so, of course, I had to also test the equipment. So in 1989, I went to Haftom and decided to, went for a new, another new climb on Haftom called the Kali Yuga. And this, for me, this was very scary because I hadn't really done any big walls since I had been rescued. And the northwest face of Haftom was cold, and it was late in the season in November. But I felt like, okay, I have a shelter that I'm not going to get rescued again. So maybe that was my first wall since I've been rescued.
Oh,
3 years before.
Oh, I see. あの3年前に、まあ、ハーフドームでレスキューされて、その後ルフェンジェはもう全然あのちょっと行きにくかったんですけども、3年後に初めてまた帰ってきた。
Yeah. So, you know, that was a, so that was, you know, just again, you know, it's like that to me when I was there, I was like, this I'm so glad to be back. Another big pendulum. I'm actually running across for this feature here. A very, very difficult, you know. It's aid climbing, but it's still very challenging and technical. And then I climbed the second ascent of the Sheep Ranch, and, you know, very steep. And so you're climbing with these tools, but it feels like you're just, you know, there is a flow to it once you, so that it is, even though it's not free climbing, it's still a very interesting type of climbing, I believe, and fun, you know, and just the only way to go there. And also the Zion National Park in Utah, so many 600 meter walls, and did a lot of new routes. This one here we did, and you can see, like, now we're using, you know, we're using the pitons and all sorts of different gear again. Just love the colors and the, you know, the geometry and the shapes, and just really fun to be up for many days, you know. So the idea for me for big walls is like every day is a climbing day, no other choice, you know.
あのザイオンはユタのずっと南にあって彼がいるアリゾナから非常に近いんですね。で、大体400から500メーターぐらいの完璧がバンバンあるんで、ただあのクオリティが全然違いまして、あの予選機は花崗岩ですごい硬いんですけど、こちらは砂岩なんで一見硬そうなんですけども、すごい柔らかい部分もあってなかなか難しいらしいんですね。で、こっちであの難しいクライミングをやって予選機に行くと、なんかちょっと簡単になるっていう話ですけどね。
And of course, you know, we have these moments where it's like we just done a new route and we're on top and the rainbow comes out and oh, you know, everything's good. This is why we like to climb. This is Xavier, who I climbed.
彼と一緒にトランウェイ行くことになります。
Yeah. And again, you know, going back to, like, of course, you know, for me, like, the best climbing day I ever had was climbing the nose in one day, because you're just free climbing, and you know that is actually a great way to climb. And so I was free climbing. I wrote that article in 1984, and then 1992 I climbed it again, and you know, just figuring out the most efficient way to climb. You know, and so many people have followed the type of, you know, and this is all you need for nose. So I think it was 12 hours, you know. And then also getting back to cold walls, you know, like very cold up in Wyoming. And this is the north face, so always cold and freezing. So, you know, you wear the clothes. This is your ski suit, by the way. And I knew right there. And then in 1991, I climbed Tribal Right, and every day, raining, stormy. But I knew, like, the portages that were designing were ready for anything. They could withstand any kind of storm, very confident. This was our view. Every day our view was like this. Very, very, except for like maybe a moment where it opened up. So that was our part of it there. And so that, I felt like then I was ready for a new trip to Triangle Towers in 1992. And, you know, I read about the Japanese team on Minamura. I was a big hero because he had soloed Triangle Tower, and it was like that's where the ultimate big walls are. And Hoshina had climbed the Great Triangle, and it was time for me to try to go there too. But there wasn't much information. This was the only two articles that had a picture. These were the only two pictures I had seen of Great Triangle at the time. And this was, of course, the Norwegian team. They went in 1984, and they made it to the top, and they probably rappelled down to here, and then they died. Still, I think what happened is they came down here, and they looked down there, and they thought, oh, let's go that way. And because it looks easier, I think, but once this is very dangerous down here, because their bodies were spotted in the gully there. And of course, and then Hoshina and his team had done the second ascent in 1990. And so, but we didn't have any information about that. It's very hard to find information about. But this, I had this picture, but I had never seen this until afterwards. And this was the original Norwegian route, and this is the, I guess, Japanese route to the top. And so we wanted to give it a go. So we, after many, many weeks, as these trips go, you get to the base and you see it for the first time, and you're like, whoa. But I started to make the maps, you know, of how to get up there and sketch the map, and we decided to try to climb over here on the left. So again, you know, making the maps is very important. And we picked out this route. So the Norwegian buttress is here, and we picked out a route to the left. And this is actually a big flake, and the Norwegian route goes to the left of the flake. We knew there was another good line to the right. So like all good trips, you know, you have to get to the base. So this is our advanced camp, and we had to get up here. This is very dangerous gully. All of this was avalanching every day. And we were reminded of the sad event of the Norwegian team. We found their helmet. We found this helmet like in here, up in the, like on the way up. And so the helmet had been crushed and pushed down the glacier. And this is because this is from the magazine Before They Die. And that's the helmet that we found. And this was in base camp. Was this in base camp in 1990? Yeah, down that base camp. So, you know, you're looking at that every day going, okay, you know, it's going to be dangerous. So this was my first time to 4,500 meters. I had to take a selfie because I was like, so out of it. And to get water, we took one of the expedition barrels and we put it under a drip and we filled it up because during the day, it's still freezing. And so this would all turn into ice, and we'd chop. Oh, that was our water supply for the first week. And eventually we got going, we started climbing. So the first 700 meters, or probably 650 meters to the snow ledge was 7 days going up this park, but beautiful climbing, really just clean, nice climbing. This raven followed us for the whole 7 days. He was always checking up on us. And finally, we were so excited to be like on the wall, you know, we're committed, ready for the. So it's the first parts where it was very technical climbing, like A3 and A4, hooks, a lot of these kind of just hooking, carefully hooking, and then more hooks, and This is Xavier wrote this iceberg. Lots of ice coming down, cars. But you know, like basically just getting up. And so I made these, you know, I made these notes as we were climbing. And just, it was really nice to just get up there. We made it to this place, and there's lots of, like, this looks like just a snowdrift, but this was big chunks of ice. If you were here, you would probably, you know, you would, this is a big avalanche that's coming down. And so there were some avalanches, but this was a safe spot because there was a bulge here. And so, you know, this is kind of what happened every day. Like, you hear it, and just like these big chunks of ice that's coming down. Again, you know, these look like little snowballs, but some of them were big pieces of ice that could just, if they hit you, they would be bad. But because this is overhanging, so it's overhanging, so a lot of the stuff was just falling behind us. And so, yeah, this was a photo that Greg Child sent me, this photo. And so we were, you know, we knew that it wasn't a safe place. So we always tried to find a place that was under an overhang. And so we knew we could try to survive. But so we did have to spend days sometimes in the Port Lands just to wait until the weather was clear. We had a hanging stove for food. And then, you know, this was actually, this is called Gollum's Gully. So this part here is up to the snow ledge. And this is actually a ledge from the 1990 expedition that was dropped there. But so we had to get up here, but we couldn't climb it during the day because during the day, there was too much ice and snow coming down. It would fall off and just crash down. So we had to climb those pitches at night. And so this picture was taken after we'd been up all night.
So we
sleep during the day, and then nighttime came and we would climb up. It took us 3 days to climb up these pitches here, from here to the snow ledge. So five pitches in that big corner. But it was beautiful. We had this, the moon was shining in to the corner. It was like the perfect timing. So we had this perfect moonlight every night. We knew we were kind of blessed. We felt like we were blessed. And we finally made it to the snow ledge. So we had a shovel, we shoveled out, and this is Xavier.
Good hotel.
So this is the only place that's not in a portal ledge, the whole part. And so we Xavier was a Swiss, and so he busted out the cheese fondue that he'd been saving for a moment. And, you know, he's stirring it here. He wouldn't let me stir because he's Swiss. Only Swiss know how to stir. No American, no, no. So we had that as a big celebration. But we still have 600 meters to go to the top. And so this is looking down at the snow ledge, and this is looking up at the climb we're doing. And you know, so the climbing was, sometimes it was and cold. But one of the keys was the Gallego, who you know, Miguel Gallego had given me these shoes. And we put those inside our plastic boots, and so we could free climb too when it was possible. And so all the upper part actually, this was a lot of like 510 and 592 and 500 slots. So we were able to free climb, you know, quite a bit, which saved so much time. And also, our biggest piece was a number four camp, so only that big. So, you know, climbing this, we just had to hope there was a place. So you really couldn't aid it because it, we didn't have the, you know, the big one here. Yeah, so we didn't, or we only had the cans that were that size, and sometimes the dark was that big. So, and, but then about that time, we got caught in a big storm for 3 days. We're up here, and this is, this square here is this, and then that circle is here, and this is us tiny humans, like, sitting up a storm. Big storm came in.
あのベースキャンプにエイスクバレーっていう非常に有名なあのフォトグラファーがついていってたので、多分下から望遠で撮ったか、あるいは海岸の山へあの登って撮ってるかです。
So three days to Spain. We drink a lot of tea and read a book. Actually, I had a book. It was okay.Xavier, no book. Oh, he was going crazy. He was like, it was so hard for him. And he didn't want to read my book because it was about the Irish potato famine. Not very interesting. But eventually the weather did clear. This was like after 3 days. Oh, we can see Nameless Tower, you know, for the first time in 3 days. And so get our boots up, back to work.Back to the job, and we did final pitches.
Wormholes.
Yeah, we called these the wormholes because there were these slots and you have to get in them, and they're very steep and overhanging, but very, very, very tricky to get through those slots. 5'9" gravel. Gravel means like you're just thrashing up. And then the final six pitches to the summit. So here we are looking up. This is at the rim. And we're looking up, and this is this type of climbing where you take your ice climbing tools and your crampons, and then you finally start seeing, you know, one of the things about, the most amazing thing about big wall climbing is that you're on the wall, you sometimes you're in a corner, your whole world is just a narrow view, and then you get to the top and suddenly, you can see it all around. So that I think is like a very special moment when you start to see. Because we couldn't see Mashabrum for the whole wall, and then all of a sudden we're seeing the whole world. And this is the final little bit to the summit, which is the east summit.
なんかビッグウォールクライミングのその面白さっていうのは、なんかその登ってる時はもうほとんどコーナーだとか、もうあの狭い中で登ってるんで、周りが何も見えないような状況で、頂上へ行った瞬間に全部周りが見えるっていう開放感って言いますか。これ多分、マシャブルーム、
マシャブルーム、
マシャブルームっていう山が対岸に見えたり、こっちの方に、maybe
ケ
チュ
ー、ケチュー、yeah,
ブロービーク、
and actually, yeah, that's my next slide, I think. So we get to the top, you know, in summit, we turn up.
これはケイトゥで、それはブロードピークで、ガシャブン4かな、
yeah.
だからそれは全部バーッと見える、その開放感
で、yeah.
それさっき彼言ったんですけど。
This is a Mustang Tower, yeah. And this is K2. Yeah. So, you know, that's kind of the reward, I guess. It's like you get to the top. And, but we got, to, you know, when we got there, it was, you know,almost night, you know, and we still had to go back down the six pitches and then back down another five pitches to our portal edge. So we only had maybe 5 minutes up there. Take a picture. got a couple quick pictures. And then 3 days to rappel down the whole the same route. And this is a story, I think, it's a story about what not to do.So we were getting down and we're lowering the bags, and we decided we're going to throw one of the haul bags off because we're going to get down there and we'll go down and we'll go to base camp, march into base camp that night. So this actually had all our sleeping bags and our warm gear. Let's get rid of it, you know. But when we got down to the snow ledge, we realized that this was a slush river. All day long. And you meters deep and 6 meters across, and just that much slush, just you couldn't cross it. And so we had to spend one more night with no bindi gear and wait until 4 o'clock in the morning when we could, when this was settling down and we could cross
down. こう下ろすのも面倒くさいから、えいやってこう蹴飛ばして、多分下にコロンコロン落ちてどっかで止まってると思ったら、それがなんか急な溝みたいなのがあって、そこをビューンと飛んでいって、全然遥か下へ行っちゃって、この一晩は中にスリーピングバッグから何から全部入ってたんで、昨日昨日まで出なくちゃいけなかったっていう話です。
It's out of here. This is out here when he realized what we did. but eventually we made it safely down, and Ace came up to take this photo, and then we were happy. This is the first time we felt safe for 18 days. The first time we didn't feel like any minute we could get an avalanche to crash down and. So that was a great moment. Listen, Xavier actually, we didn't have a pen, and he had all these cuts and bruises, so he pulled a scab off, and this is his blood.
Oh, 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 oh,わーっと溶けていくような自由になった感じ、まだ生きてるなっていう感じが、まあ、彼ら二人の顔に出てます。やっぱり18日間ずっと壁にいると自分では気づかないかもしれないけど、ずっと緊張感みたいなのに攻められ続けてですね、で降りてきてこれは絶対安全だってところになると、それが全部禁止されてこういう幸せな顔になる。
Okay, so after Trago, I'm going to design some more gear and a little bit of climbing. I climbed Observatory and maybe another 5 or 6 walls. But mostly I decided I was going to design, I just focused on designing better equipment for this kind of thing. And so this was a portal edge with a fully enclosed fly. This is on the north base of Nameless Tower, and that was actually a very cold route, because you never see the sun on that, and so they needed something better. And then this was for Patagonia, so this could be anchored, you can anchor it top and bottom, and so when the winds come you don't get blown out. So that was like another new idea to enable, like, even, and that was used on a very key ascent in Patagonia, and they, it was one of the first times that they climbed Escudo in, I think it was 1993 or 4, and it was one of the first big walls in Patagonia that wasn't using a lot of rope, fixed rope.
Oh, I see.
Because they could stay, before you had the anchor down, like with this kind of ledge in Patagonia, you just go flying up. So this was sort of designed to be aerodynamic and be able to anchor from below. Mm. Mm. So that was a new idea,
パタゴニアは多分ご存知だと思いますけど、風がもうものすごいんですね。で、それをボダリジ、普通のフォアのボダリジだったら、フォアを一発で通されますから、ここに特別なアンカーを打って、それで下に壁にこう貼り付けてあって、風の抵抗をできるだけ抑えるように、ああいう作りにしてるんだと思います。もしフラットなままだったら一発で持ってられて、どっかに飛んでいきます。
This one also had a good strong point. You could anchor it, but it was, that was a better design for the wind. And this is a famous photo that I think has been on Instagram and TikTok a million times. But these were portal edges that were designed, that were made for the north face. And you know, eventually I decided maybe I making my own business was difficult. Maybe I'd work for North Face and I could use like more, you know. So I sold my company to North Face and worked for them for 2 years, and you know, made, because they had better access to fabrics that we could use, you know. So it was nice to work for them for a couple years, and we made this photo was in National Geographic, about an attempt, I think, on a Cali cigar. So, you know, we were able to just make lighter, stronger, more effective gear for lightweight alpine with big walls. But I also was working on other things. This was, I just like to show, because for a while, Camp 4 was going to be gone. There was a flood in 1988, and they were going to just, this is Camp 4, and they were going to build like hotels here. All these campgrounds would have been, you know, hotels and Swan Slab, which anybody's been to Yosemite, this is a wonderful area to sort of get away from things. And that was all going to be hotels and condos. So we said no, and we with Tom Frost, we were able to stop the development. But after that, I decided maybe I'd try something new, and I became a river guide in the Grand Canyon, and that was a great experience of, you know, telling stories and pushing the boat through big rapids, and so that was a different thing. But I really enjoyed that for 5 years or 6 years. And that's where I met my wife, Jenny, on the Grand Canyon. And we had two wonderful kids. One of them was here. This was a long time ago. we moved to Tasmania in Australia. So we decided we wanted to just have a more quiet lifestyle. And so we moved to Tasmania. And I started climbing again because I was interested in showing my children how to climb. And we go to Rapleys, and Rowan, in a few years, like, he was able to climb on his own with his friends. And because of Rapleys, is who's been to Rapleys in Australia? I know some of you. Yeah, Hoshina's done one of the hard routes there, but it's a really nice climbing area where there's easy routes and there's hard routes. It's a great place, and my youngest daughter, who's now 11, you know, we climbed with her there. But somehow I decided, it's, how do you say, a moth to a flame? Like a moth to a flame, is that an expression? You know, like a moth to a flame, like going back to...
India.
What's that? So I decided oh, maybe I'm going to design gear again. And this is after 20 years of not really designing climbing gear. And somehow I decided, oh, I think it was because nothing had, since no advantages to portal edges had been made since 1997. And I thought, because Black Diamond bought our design, and I thought, oh, this is going to be something better. And so I started tinkering with new shapes and came up with, like, instead of having the block corners, a frame that could just snap together. And I went to Yosemite and made the first one, and then just started playing with shapes. So this was a fun experimental time. You know, this was the original A5 design, which was the state of the art for 20 years, and then I started playing around, and I kind of came up with the idea that this shape with the wall, instead of being next to the wall, you actually face out from the wall. And it actually turns out to be a much more stable design and stronger too. So I started getting that organized, and of course I had to test it, and so after 20 years, I went to do a climb in Australia that would have been one of the easiest walls when I was climbing hard. But after climbing with Simon Benz, who he was the stronger partner, And he asked me afterwards, he goes, this is a 300 meter wall, pretty easy, but for me it was hard. And he said, so what's this like compared to Great Triangle? And I said, it feels about the same. Because it was hard for me as an older person. But then, you know, but basically we're testing the Portolans to make sure it worked before I would sell it to anyone else. And set up the shop, and it was, I guess it would be nice to explain this. So it was like the old days, you know, where like local climbers would come by and help me design, and so it was like that kind of energy I've had in '85. This is Malcolm Matheson, who's one of Australia's best climbers, you know, and he would come over and help me bend frames, and, you know, people would come and sew. Yeah, so that was fun to recreate that kind of energy at A5, you know, that was. But, you know, now this design, I only made about 50 of them, but I got them out with Timmy O'Neill and, like, with all these climbers. And this is Mark, so he used it in Baffin, and everybody says it's a better, you know, it's a better way to go. Like, Mark calls it the perfect portalage, and so it's kind of a different experience, you know. To be sticking out from the wall rather than next to the wall. So that was fun, but I felt like that was done. And so, you know, this is just more pictures of the Delta Legs. It's on the cover of the Yosemite Guide. But basically, I finished and I just made everything open source. So how would you say open source?
What?
Open source.
Open source.
Yeah. So open source means anybody can use my design.
Oh, okay. パテントとか作り方をこうパブリックにみんなにこう教えて自由に作りなさいっていう、その特許なんかを申請しないで自由に作っていいよってこう広めてるんだそうです。
So all that's on big walls, and some people are making them in the But then I started to get involved. This is just the last few slides, but I started to get involved with the living in Tasmania. The forests are getting chopped down, and some of the activists who protest were needed a portalage, so I would give them my prototypes. And I realized, like, also they could use the whole climbing idea of going alpine style. So this is like an alpine style protest. Going in with just a pack on your back and setting up a camp and preventing the bulldozers from taking the trees down.
So, 森林保護運動みたいなそういう活動をやってるみたいで、木をバンバン切る人がなんかいるらしいんですけど、それをなんかできるだけ切らないでくれっていう運動をやってるみたいです。
So yeah, I've been involved with that for a bit, and so.I'm making these and also teaching the activists how to make their own portaledges, which before they were using a bed frame from a tip, you know, heavy bed frame and a piece of plywood. So it was very difficult to put in them. And now with these, they can just go up with a small pack and set up the protest. So they're blockading, you know, the bulldozers want to come in, but they can't come in because there's somebody in the tree.
タスマニアは熱帯雨林 その地域でもあってものすごい雨が降って、でその代わり森林がすごい密生してるらしいんですね。で非常に貴重な自然が残ってるのをそれをこう伐採したりするらしいんですけど、でそういう活動家たちはなんかすごい重い小屋みたいなものを多分それまで上げてたらしいんですけど、それをこのポータルエッジで代用してアプティマに作れるんで非常に便利だと。
So for like one day we made this one day, the next day in the forest, and then the next day in the police headquarters. So, but we can make them fast up. So what I do now is I'm trying to make simpler designs that are cheap. So this ledge only costs about 150, so maybe you know, 15,000 yen to build this whole 50,000 yen.
Wow.
And, you know, very cheap, right? So because we're using heavier, we're using, it's still very strong, but we're just using more.
なんか1万5000円で作れるって話ですけどね、本当は。
But still strong and simple design.
ベンダーがいるんだ。
So in a way, I'm devolving the design. You know, like I'm making the design from complicated to simple. So that it can be made quickly. Oh, so this is the area of Tasmania. This is protected. Forest, beautiful forest. This is an incredibly beautiful forest up here. Old growth, 500 year old trees. Most amazing forest, but it's all being chopped. Like slowly but surely, it's all going to be gone before my children have, their children will never see it. So we want to protect that, and we're doing that through
protection. 赤いところが全部カットされて、どんどんどんどん侵食されてきてる。で、それをまあ止めましょうっていう運動をやってる。そうです。
It makes me for the past four, 5 years, anytime they go in here, there's cortices in the trees and then they stop. So that's been effective, this kind of thing. And the idea is that this is attached to a machine. So the bulldozer is here.This is attached to a bulldozer.
Uh-huh.
So the bulldozers come in, they start to take the forest out, and then at night the activists go in and they tie anchors so they can't move the bulldozer. So that's how the process happens. And so they have to take this person down before they can go back to work. So the idea is this is public land too. This is a public forest.And so it's basically the government doesn't care about forests, and we're trying to set them on the right course. And then this is just the last bit. For 2 years I worked on these books, which is just a history of tools and how tools have helped climate. So it's, but, you know, as you can tell, I like the equipment and the tools, and so I decided to research the 100-year history. And you know, this is just some pages discovering, you know, how they sort of figured it out, and the women who were kind of ignored in history, but had very important roles in the development. And also, I this is how I've become friends with Hoshina. I get some more information from here in Japan. And I found out the silk ropes that Maki was using for Alberta, you know, they were actually quite advanced ropes. So Maki is, does everybody know who?
Maki Yuko-san, Masu no Taichou.
Yeah, who knows his mind? I mean, is it common knowledge?
Yes, I think so. Yeah.
So he, you know, he was a very big pioneer.
Alberta を登ってるんですよね。
Yeah. Anyway, that's difficult information in because a lot of American history books don't know much about it. So I wanted to find out more. And and basically the research goes up to the 1950s. I haven't gotten past that yet, but you know, basically that was the age of where pitons were enabling new types of mines. And those books are on Amazon, and I've also had some articles in the journals. So, thank you. That is my presentation.
はい、それではご清聴ありがとうございました。今、20時20分を少し過ぎたところです。予告通り10分程度の休憩を挟みまして、その後、お二人のディスカッションを見せていただきたいと思います。では今21分ですので、30分くらいに再開したいと思います。では休憩です。お願いします。後ろでサインを こられたなというのがあって、はい、では後半といっても時間のこともありますので、そんなに長くはならないかと思いますが、最初の説明で、まあ、お話しした通り、今から、坂下さんとジョンミッテルドルフさん、あと、まあ、こちらにいる、シナさん、あと南浦さんにもできるだけ入っていただいて、主に2つの内容についてトークしていただきます。皆さん覚えていらっしゃいますか？最初に2つこれとこれのお話をというふうにお話しましたけど、覚えてますか？はい、一つが A ファイルという概念、この概念というのが少しポイントです。単純なグレードというより、それ以上のものがそこには込められているというふうに考えていただければスッと入るかなと思います。一つ目が A ファイルという概念で、二つ目が、ジョンの考える岩との向き合い方、その態度というものになります。 A ファイルという概念と岩との向き合い方、態度、この2つに、まあ、注意を払って聞いていただければと思います。それではお願いします。
A ファイル、ここで登ってる人何人か、石本さんとか、まあ、南浦さん、星野さん、あとひょっとしたら何もっと大勢の人が登ってるかもしれないですけど、私はA3 までしか登ってなくて、ノーズとソラトとシールドとあとファフドムしか登ってないんで、全然その経験が不足してて彼に質問する資格はないんですけれども、でもまあここにいる人たちのサポートを得てちょっと質問してみたいと思います。I think artificial climbing standard or grade is different from dismal sports climbing or free climbing dismal grade. So dismal is there's no almost no limit. However, if five is an almost roof,
yeah,
ceiling,
yeah.
Maybe someone say A5 plus, but it's a completely different idea or concept from dismal. So what is your impression about A5 grade?
Yeah.
Or how do you think about the concept of A5 system?
Yeah, so it's a good question because the A grading, the A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, for a while, there's a history of how it evolved into that kind of grade, because even with free climbing, like 5.9 was the top grade.
Yeah.
And A climbing, people thought maybe we go A6, A7, A8, but I think people who have done hard aim and been scared, you know, they know that that it's just a number, and it's really almost you're using that number to tell your friends, okay, it's scary, right? It's be careful on this because it's going to be scary. And so I think it's really a number, but it's not about the number. It's about the idea that the natural way to climb is going to be very marginal, very, you're going to have to use a lot of these kind of hooks and maybe a little tiny hook that's like maybe it holds. But you know, you're doing it without, the idea is that you're climbing without bolts, really. So if you want to do a route and not put the bolts in, because the idea with big wall climbing is that if you use bolts, then obviously anything can be climbed. And so the idea was like, how much can you get away with by using these tools? And this piton only goes in that far, But would you use it? Well, it'll hold the body weight, but nothing more. So the idea of A5 is like, that's sort of the maximum fear that a climber can experience. Hmm. So the A5 has just become, that's the limit of where you're going to be so scared that you might put in bolts, you know? And so I think once you're able to start trusting this piton that's only in that far, okay, you know, maybe it's good, or maybe it's not. And, you know, but basically just getting away with the minimum amount of impact. So I think the idea of A5 is that's just sort of become tradition, that's the maximum that you can do without. We used to call it short circuiting. So like basically, no, too much, you know, you couldn't do anymore. That was A5. So that's kind of how it became just A5. It's the grade. Because when this is just in and you're looking, this pops, you might fall 20, 30 meters, there might be ledges. That's when you have to really believe that it's going to hold, right? Like, you have to just believe. And then maybe there's a good piece, yes. But the A5 means that there's going to be lots of tiny things that might hold your body weight, but they won't catch a fall, you know? And so it's a way to share with other climbers. If I tell Lindy Murrah that's A5 up there, he's gonna know what it is. I don't have to say, well, it's A4 minus plus, you know. So usually, you know, that is the maximum that is possible, really. Does that make sense?
Yeah. フリークライミングにおけるデシマル の難しくなるとどんどんどんどんこう数が上がっていくじゃないですか。で、まあそれと基本的には同じかもしれないけど、要するにこう高くなっていくと難しくなるという時点では同じかもしれないですけど、A1 から A5 へのあるいは A0 へのその過程っていうのはもう少し技術的っていうよりも、まあもちろん技術が含まれるんですけど、 A5 っていうのはもう絶対この恐怖は耐えられない、これ以上の恐怖は耐えられないっていったところを、まあ、彼は言うんですね。でそれはそのちょっとしたまあこういう一人でもズブッと入ってガチンと止まってればこんなのは誰も怖くはないんですけど、これがこのぐらいしか入んなくて本当に支えられるかどうかわからなくて、そこに当然こう釣り具を巻いてそこにこう乗った時にこれ多分すっぽ抜けるな、いやすっぽ抜けないかもしれない。でだけどこれすっぽ抜けたら10メーターを掘ってそこに岩の棚があってそこに多分ぶつけられて死ぬなってそう思いながら、うん、これは耐えられないっていうところが A5 だっていう、そういう感じでいいんですかね。
はい、少しだけ補足、はい、まあ、ジョーが言っていたのは今坂下さんに言っていただいたほぼその通りです。ジョンが最初に言っていたポイントで非常に重要なのが、ボルトを極力打たないというところです。彼が言うには、ボルトを、まあ、手で打つにしても何にしても打ち込んでしまったら、まあ、極端な話、どんなビッグウォールでもどんなに平らな壁でも登ることができてしまう。そうではなくて、ボルトはもう極力使わず、自然の形状にああいったギアを用いて前進をしていく。というのがエイドクライミングの、まあ、心情としているところです。それを前提として考えたときに、どれだけ、彼はマージンという言葉を使いましたけど、どれだけ信用ならない、心もとないギアで進まなければいけないかというところが A4、A5 というふうに数字が上がると、例えば 彼が南浦さんにあのルートは A5 だと言うと、南浦さんとしてはおそらくそのルートで何が待っているかというのを予想できる。どれだけ恐ろしいか、どれだけ死の危険と隣り合わせになるかというのを聞いた人は想像できる。そういう数字の指標なんだ。なので恐ろしさとか、まあ、危険度も含まれますけど、それを表しているので A5 というのがまあ圧倒的なその上の限界、上限としてある。それを超えることは恐らくないだろうというふうに言われています。
でそのグレードは要するにただ友達にその難しさを伝えるための手段なので、だから例えば南浦さんにあそこは、うん、実は A3 だったんだよって言って、南浦さんが言ったらなんだよこれ A5 じゃねえかよって言えるそのコミュニケーションの仕方もありますよね、多分。
サンドバ
ッキングってやつ、ね、絶対的なそのグレードっていうのはなくて、ただその恐れに対してどれだけ そのストレスがあるかっていうことなんで、自分が克服したやつはその対抗意識を持ったやつに対してはちょっと低くグレードしたり、それから生意気なやつにはちょっとその高くつけておいて、あの脅かしたりすることもたまにはあると思います。
では僕が思うことは、そのまあピッチなりピッチに対するグレードですけども、あの初等者が登った結果なんですよね。あ、A5 になったというか、辛抱してボルトを打たないでなんとかかんとかギリギリの、あのそれこそちょっとしか入らない、効いてない、要するにボディウェイトオンリーですよね、効いてないってやつ、とても墜落には耐えられないのがずっと続いていって、最後までワンピッチ、50メーターあるいはレンジがあるところで、ギリのいいところで切ったときに、あ、辛抱して、ボルト打たないで、途中に中間視点でボルト打たないでいけた、結果として A5 になった。なったり A4 になったり、まあ、中間に一発ドレリングしてペッツルのとこ次の打ったらもう、ね、絶対大丈夫ですから、かなりそこまでのその下までのグレードと上のグレードと変わってくるから、まあ、結果として A5 なり A4 なり、まあ、どのグレードっていうのができるんで、だからそれ以上にやっぱりボルトを打たないっていう、ね、さっきもあの訳してもらったけど、ボルトを打たない意思っていうかね、それ以外の可能性がね、何かないかなって思って、初頭でもファーストアセンドもそうやってやって、でセカンドアセンドの時は逆に、ここは A5 だよ、A4 だよって言われると、でもできてしまってるから、すごいプレッシャーなんですよ。ボルトヒットもできないからね、基本的に。もしかしたらのために、あのリバークのためにレッジとかで、あの収納点とかで打ったりするけども、基本的にそのしかもアメリカのルートで日本人たる者がそのルート行ってボルトを途中で打ってしまったらもう腹切り者ですからねだからそれはもうリピートとかフォアつけられるということです、はい。
I wish I could understand because that sounded good. But yeah, so it's something that you just know when you're climbing. I mean, I guess like this was an example where, you know, we had to put in, X means that we're putting a rivet, not a bolt, but a small
rivet.
A rivet, yeah. So that's a rivet, and then maybe this was 5, 10 meters. And so this is A4 here because that you're using a lot of like hooks in between. So obviously you could just drill. It would take longer though. So it takes longer. So you want to have use the skills of using these small tools to be able to climb really quicker and more efficient in a way, you know. But you're trading more fear for quickness, right? So it's a trade-off between fear and how fast you can climb, yeah.
なんか星はよく、まあ、大体まあ同じ意見なんですけど。 ども、それプラス付けて加えることは、まあ、ボルトを使わない代わりに、まあ、ビクオール の, そのギアっていうのは、いろんなものがありますよね。コアヘッドとか、まあ、フックもそうだし、ハーケンなんかもいろんなサイズあるんですけども、それを使いこなすなんか職人的な技みたいなのが必要で、それを要はボルトを使わない代わりに、その目の前にあるこう課題に対してどれを使っていくかみたいな、そのまあ面白さだったりとか、その職人技のこうやっぱり一応一旦にはそれできないと思うんですよ。徐々に徐々に磨いていくっていう、その辺の面白さと美しさはあったなと。でなおかつそれを怖い、その恐怖の状況で素早く頭の中を回転させて選んで使っていくっていうのが、まあ、のアメリカの世界かなと思いました。
石黒さん、あの何本か登られてますから。
いや、そんな
あとま
ま私が発言するのはそれ多いですからね。
いや、石黒君が一番ありがたいと思います。
一応、ね、私、ご飯会社の石黒と申します。皆さんおはようございます。私は1992年の予選に出て、シー・オブ・ドリームズを持って、その後、あのパートナーの谷口が、まあ、一緒にやったんですけど、帰っちゃったので、一人になったものですから、ソロで全員アメだったものを持って、で、なんか物足りなかったので、ちょっと誰かいないかなって、あのキャンプ4にあの裏の制度がいいと思うんですから、裏もちょっと付き合えっていうので一緒にオーロラを持って、それで3本の A5 を満日に登って、一応当時の世界記録だったそうですけど、今は変わっていませんが、まあ、あの小坂さんおっしゃるように、あのギアをですね、ジョンが作ったその A5 のギアをこう選定しながら、いかに速く、これは4分の1インチだな、あこれはあの新、ロングシーンのバックアップでいいなと、まあ、だけ言うと頭の中で計算しながら A1 のルートだったらそう、まあ、はめてって打ってっていかに速く登るかっていうのが面白かったですね。でかなりピッチであの一生残ってるのはシー・オブ・ドリームズ・アポ、フックオア・ブックって、うん、あのフッキング30回ぐらいトラバースで使うところがあるんですよ。それ落ちたら大フリカになっちゃって、であのこっちにレッジがあるんですから大怪我するんですよね。でこれ落ちらんないなと思って、本当にビビりながら行ってもいい気がした。あとあのジョンが言ってたみたいなあのフレーク、うん、あのやばいフレークで言うとオーロラにゴングフレークって、今はなきゴングフレークというのがありまして、それはあのピンを打つとボーン、中が空洞なもんですからボーンとゴングみたいに響くんですよ。で今はなきって言ったのは、その後2、3年してそのゴングフレークは落ちちゃったんですよ。真ん中でノリでくっついてたみたいなフレークなもんですから、それを私登った時はやべえなと思って、これはお父さんお母さんせっかく産んでくれたけど、これで俺の人生はおしまいになっちゃうから申し訳なかったって思いながら行きましたけど、ね、うん、エリキャッターで印象はありますが、復興は僕とゴンフレークですね、はい、恐ろしかったです。もう二度と行きません。
すいません、先ほどあのちょっとジョンがあの手短に述べたことを訳してなかったのであれですけれども、ジョーカーさんの繰り返し言っていたのは、ボルトを打つと確かに安全性は上がるけれども、とにかく時間がかかると。その代わりに、エイドギアを駆使して登ると、怖いけれども、より速く登ることになる。その、まあ、彼はエフィシエンシー、効率っていうふうに言ってましたけど、そのエフィシエンシーと怖さ、恐怖感っていうのはトレードオフだっていうふうに言ってるんです。
ありがとうございます。まあ、これは結構気にないところなんで、次のスタイルとエフェクトは日本風に言うと倫理観ってことになっちゃうんですけど、なんかごめんどくさい感じがしますけど、要はその岩登りするときどういう こう精神性で登っていくかっていうことだと思うんですけど、さっきそのミニマムなインパクトっていうのは中島から話がありましたけど、こう彼のそのエセックについて書いてあるところは、その何か壁と対峙するときに、その倫理観というのは個人が岩に対してのリスペクト、岩に対して尊敬の念を持ってたり愛情を持ってたりするわけですけども、それに比例するんじゃないかと。でだから人によって結構違うかもしれません。だけどやっぱり岩っていうのは一回傷つけたら元に戻らないし、ひょっとしたら世界で唯一の岩なのかもしれないし、だからそういったことをよく考えて、自分がそのボルトを打つときっていうのは、あるいは岩をまあチッピングしたり、あるいはこう傷つけたりすることが、どれだけその長い年月岩に傷跡を残すのか、そういうことも考えなくちゃいけないというかに書いてるんですね。でまあ実際書いてることと、それから彼がここで話すことがまたちょっと違うかもしれないので、そのことについて質問してみたいと思います。 You were mentioned
Ethics.
And with Walt,
yeah.
Ethics grows from an individual's respect for the law.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's very, very important things for every crimes.
Mm-hmm.
And minimum impact becomes the name of the game.
Mm-hmm.
For Pastor Sand, this translating to minimum voting and debating never bring, unless also absolutely no natural placement is available,
yeah.
And a minimum block. This kind of stuff.
So yeah, well, like rock sculpting, I think, yeah, even in the 1930s, people would use their hammer to make footholds and handholds. That was part of climbing. In the 1930s in New York, you know, it's like natural to, climbing, and there's no handhold here, hit the rock. So I think it's about like looking at the rock as a sort of a landscape, like it's a puzzle. How can you get from here to there without, you know, making a lot of changes to the rock? It's but also it's about the shared experience too. So I guess that's the first point I would make. It would be the rock has a natural path that you can climb as a human. And so you're following the natural path in a way, using the tools that you have, and sometimes it means putting things with a hammer in the rock, but you know, putting the piton in is I guess it's more, it's putting it in is less impact than drilling a hole. You know, that's the idea. So you're using the natural features of the rock to make your way up. Yeah. So there is a natural, like seeing the natural. You're looking at it like a landscape or like blank canvas in a way, and you're making it up. You're creating the path, you know, using the least amount of tools, really.
Hmm.
But you know, I think what's interesting is it's a shared experience. Have you climbed the Pacific Ocean? Have you climbed? Yeah.
So,
but you know, there's like places where there's like a famous place on the Pacific Ocean where there's like one of these pitons and it's bent and it's only in about that far, and you have to clip, put your rope through it, and then you have to lower down and run across. And so, you know, obviously that's a very scary moment, but then we share the experience and we can laugh about it. But if somebody just put in like a nice big 3/8 inch bolt, it wouldn't be anything, you know. So there is sort of that experience that, you know, the first ascent did it that way, and that was their art masterpiece, you know, like Bridwell put it in and the piton bent, and everybody since then, and it's everyone who goes by is amazed that it's still holding, you know, pull out. But, you know, you're swinging across and you're, and if it popped, it would be not very, it's very scary. But everybody's done it, you know, hundreds of people have done it, and it's a shared experience of following that path, you know, as opposed to just clipping the strong bolts and being like, oh, of course, you know. So there is that too, I think. It's like the first ascent is creating a piece of art, and then you're respecting that piece of art, I guess, in a way, too.
最初私がやって大会でやってるんですけど、前回でも、僕になってます。1930年ぐらいから、その、クライミングが、その、やってる人が、ハンマーで、岩を叩いて壊して、その、ボルトにしたとか、そういう話は結構あって、何も古い、何も新しい話ではないと。ただ、結局、岩っていうのは、まあ、自然なもんで、で、言ってみればこうキャンバスみたいなもんだ。で、その白いキャンバスにどういうラインを描くか。で、やっぱりその割れ目が、細い割れ目があったら、そこにピトンを打って、まあ、それを使って登っていく方が、ボルトを、岩に穴を開けて、ボルトを打つよりも全然、まあ、綺麗に見えるんではないかと。で、そこがその結構大事なところで、それでなんかなんとかっていうイベントのとこになんかピトンが、古いピトンが一方あるの。
パシフィック・オーシャン。
え？
パシフィック・オーシャン。
ああ、パシフィック・オーシャン。それをなんかもう諸島の人たちが、諸島の人が打ったやつがぐにゃっと曲がってて、でもそれ使っていかないと、あの、
振り子ドラマ
する。振り子。で、ものすごい、あの、パッと見るとこれ使えないような人なんで、でも、諸島の人がそれ使っていってるんで、それを次の人も使っていってて、で、まあ非常にこう、怖いんだけど、でもそれに対してこう敬意を払いながら同じことをやって、そこにもし誰かがボルトを打ったら確かに安全になるけど、それはやっぱりその自然のキャンバスを傷つけることになるんじゃないかっていう、大体そんな話だと思ったんだけど、まだ考えてもいっぱいある
そんなにいっぱいはないですけど、彼が言ってたのとおり、今の話だとキーワード2つあります。1つは、ナチュラルパスっていう言い方をしてました。その自然の形状を使って登るっていうところにすごく関係しますけど、ジョンは岩にはその自然にできたパス、道ですね、自然な道筋ってものがあると。それはクラックだったりコーナーだったり、まあ、もしくはあの本当に欲しいフレークただの横隔だったりするかもしれませんけど、そういうナチュラルパスをたどっていくことが美しい。あの真っ白なキャンバスっていうと何もないものをちょっと想像しますけど、必ずどこかにナチュラルパスがある、それを辿るみたいな。でそうした時にあのさっきの話に出たようなパシフィックオーシャンウォールの、その曲がったしかもちょっとしか入ってない恐ろしい人を使ってのトラバースというものも出てくる。でもう一つ言っていたキーワードというのが、諸島藩というのはピースオブアートって言ってます。アートなんですよ。 ある種の芸術だと。なので、まあ、諸島藩っていう行為がその芸術があるのであれば、それをこう追体験していく、次の人たち、再登する人たちはそれをまず リスペクトすべき、敬意を払うべきだということを彼は話してくれました。
It's always a gray line, you know, but I think it's about just like if I was to climb Minamura's route on Steppenwolf, I would want to respect the piece of art he created, you know, like I wouldn't want to just be like, oh, this is scary, I could put it in a bowl. I would want to, you know, it's his masterpiece of on Trango, and so it, you know, it'd be interesting to put oneself in that position to see the piece of art he created, you know, basically. And, it, you know, if you can free climb, yeah, free climb is funner, you know, but sometimes you can't and you have to use these kind of tools, but it's about, you know, the minimum. It's really, I guess, it does come from a ground up. You start on the ground and you go up, you know, as opposed to, you know, I think that's the main concept that is difficult to, because that was the way you always climbed. You started on the ground and you climbed up. And so you didn't have the opportunity to put in the good pieces for making it possible to free climb. It's a puzzle. What's the most efficient way to climb up? Well, I could, you know, I'm gonna use some of these things, I'm gonna free climb some, and you're creating a work of art in a way, you know? Does that make sense?
No,
I think the idea is you're starting on the ground, yes. And what's more efficient if you're starting, if you have to start.
一番基本になる考え方としてもう地面から始めて岩のトップまで行く、それが基本だと。でそれはパズルのようなものだっていうふうによく言いますよね。彼は今そういうふうに言っていて、ここからトップまでどういうふうに行こうかというふうに考える。でそこで、できるだけナチュラルな道筋を通ってこういうギアを駆使して、で場合によってはできるところではフリークライミングをして、なのでエイドのルートだからといってフリークライミングをしないってわけでもないんですよ。できるところは自分の手足で登ればいいし、でもそれだけで進めない場所は道具を駆使して、それも言ってみれば自分にとっての技なんですね。それを駆使して登っていくっていうところにやっぱり彼が重きを置いている、そういう印象ですね。
今日ジョンに来てその A5 の話だとか、その人工投函のためのギアの話だとかしていただいたのは、ほんの少しでもそのスポーツクライミングでなんかそのギアに頼らないクライミングっていう具合にみんな信じてると思うんですけれども、結局やってるのはボルトをたくさん15メーターとか20メーターの間に3メーター置きとか4メーター置きとかにボルトをたくさん打ってて、それは決して美しいことではないんじゃないか、あるいはその人の本当の岩に対する、リスペクトで、果たしてそれが本当に正しいのかどうかっていうのをちょっと考えていただきたいなと思ったことです。で今日ジョンと昼飯食いながらそのことについてもちょっと話しています。ただ今メインストリームがスポーツクライミングの方に行ってるので、こういうことを大っぴらに言うのはなんかどうかなとは思うんですけれども、でもやっぱりそのアーティフィシャルクライミングの持つ可能性みたいなのも当然あるし、それがないと登れない山もたくさんあると思うし、だからなんかワンピッチのスポーツクライミングの枠で全てのクライミングを見る
あるいは判断する、捉えるっていうのは少し危険かなと。で、もうちょっと違うビゴールの考え方とか、スーパーアルファインプランニングの考え方とかを、それぞれこういい長所だとか、優れたところがあるんで、それを縦断、横断するようなあの考え方をしていただけるといいかなと思って、彼をあのここに呼びました。あのなかなかすごい研究家ですし、それからその先ほど回した本なんか見ててもものすごい熱量ですね。それで深く入っていく力が凄まじいので、なんかまたその機会があれば別ないろんな他の話もしてもらいたいなと思っています。どうも今日は本当ありがとうございました。
はい、あの速やかな進行にご協力いただきありがとうございました。で少し時間に余裕があるかなと、想定があるかなと思いますので、せっかくですので、皆さんの方からも、ぜひあのジョンに聞いてみたいことがあれば、できる限り訳しますので、日本語でも結構です。何かあれば、お願いします。はい、では、マイクいきますので、やっぱり。
スライドとトークありがとうございました。お聞きしたいのが、今日本語でいいですか？
大丈夫です。
ヨセミテのエルキャピタン、フリークライミングがこう主流だと思うんですけど、例えばノーズにしても、チェンジングコーナーでボルトで打たれたじゃないですか。確かブルックさんでした。あれはフリークライミングのためのボルトっていうものに対してどう思われているのかなっていうのをお聞きしたいです。
So he pointed out that a free climb on El Capitan.
Yeah.
So now in the mainstream is free climb.
Yeah.
As you know, but so for example on the nose.
Yeah.
The changing corner is a very famous climb. Very hard.
Yeah.
Maybe 514 range free climb. But the ball, those balls. Are praised only for the pre-climbing. So how do you think about those bolts?
Are you mean new bolts?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't think there have been new bolts put mm-hmm. on that. But I think it's good. I think for especially for route like the nose or the South A or you know even the dome. You know, Tommy Caldwell's route. I think that's fair game. You know, I think it's good if it can be done from ground. You know, and if it goes free, I think that's good. But you know, I mean, all those routes it took months and months and months of work to figure out. Like Lynn Hill spent, you know, many 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 weeks working out how to climb it. So. I think it's great, you know, I think that's a very important part of the game. But, you know, obviously, if you go to the mountain, to me it's about mountains. If you go to the mountains, do you have months and months and months to work out the move? Well, probably not the weather and the time, so it's about, like, what's more efficient, again. But, you know, I think it's great, amazing, like, really, all this. There's something like, I think there's 9 or 10 free routes on El Capitan now. And those are, you know, if I could climb hard again, that would be my goal, you know. But I do believe that if you have the skills, if you can climb the 8 skills, that's going to help that kind of climbing too. Because I don't even think El Capitan has been climbed without any aid at all, for example. So everybody has used aid in the sense that they've fallen and had to use, you know, they had to practice, right? So nobody, I don't think El Cap has never been climbed where somebody walked up, had never been on it, and climbed it without any aid, you know, without any help from the, using the rope. Yet, I think it could happen, and people have come very close. And so that's really the goal, is like to be able to climb without any aid. But most of the free climbs have been climbed with a lot of aid. Like when Tommy Caldwell climbed the Dawn Wall, I mean, he used 25 times more aid than an aid climber, because he spent 3 years climbing and practicing every move. So every time he fell, that's like using aid in a way, you know. Eventually he made a free climb, but you know, he had to use a lot of aid to make it free. So I think it's just another game, another tool in the toolbox to know how to aid climb, you know. And but obviously the ultimate is being able to go up without using any aid. That's the purest form of climbing. But it, you know, even though it's called free, it wasn't free. But people went and used a lot of aid to figure out how to climb it. So, you know, it's that kind of thing, I guess.
結構長い内容だったのであれですけど、あ、いいですか、訳してしま
った。
はい。まあ、例えばビンヒルがノースのフリー側が初頭ですけれども、まあ、そういったあの今登られているフリールート、フリークライミングで登れるルートっていう、そのことは素晴らしいと思って彼は言ってるんですよ。あの岩壁をフリークライミングで登れるということは素晴らしいと。なので、その先ほど倉上さんが言っていたような、フリークライミングのために打たれたボルトっていうものを僕は否定しないっていう立場を取ってるそうです。ただ、例えばトミー・コールドとドーオーとかも、トミーが最終的に全部フリーで登ってますけど、それに至るためには、まあ、当然ボルトにテンションをかけてるわけですから、いっぱいエイドで彼は登ってるんだと。しかも、エイドクライマーの何倍もの時間をかけてあの壁に向かっていたと言える。なので、そのエイドの技術があれば、そのフリークライミングっていうものの助けには確実になるし、あと、エイドであろうともフリーであろうとも、最終的な、もう究極のゴールは、あの壁を何の、まあ、エイドの助けも借りずに、純粋に手と足で登ることだというふうに言っています。なので、目指しているところが全く違うとかいうわけではない。彼らの中では、フリークライミング、まあ、ボルトを用いてのフリークライミングだと思いますけど、フリークライミングっていうものと、彼がやってきたエイドクライミングっていうものは、別のジャンルにあるもの。だけれども、目指すところは同じだし、エイドがフリーの助けに大いになるというのが彼の意見です。
まあ、昼の時、やっぱり雑談だったんですけれども、ちょうど好きな後、ボールケアナがトランクに来て、それでこう、それをフリー化しようと思って、何回も、登り降りして、まあ、結局、諦めて帰ったんですけれども、そういうスタイルで、まあ、フリークライミングをするっていうのと、やっぱりそのビッグホール登るためには普通は効率を考えていかに早く登っていくかっていうのもすごく大事で、ひょっとしたらそうしないと生き残れなかったり、あるいは嵐に捕まって大変なことになったりする可能性も非常に高くなる。でだからどっちを選ぶかっていうのは非常に、まあ、本人の自由なのかもしれないけど、まあ、彼自身はビッグホールを登るときはエフィシェンシーの方を大事にしたい、スピードを速くしてナチュラルで、できるだけナチュラルで登れるラインを探しながら速く登って降りてくる、そっちの方が自分の好みだっていう話はしてました。
ちょっと話戻りますけど、はい、ノーズのフリーって言うけどもジャーディントラバースはティッピングじゃないですか？
あ、そう、グレードか。
え、
ジャーディントラバースもうちょっと下ですよね。
うん、はい、トゥエルブやるところ
は、
それをだからそれをクライミング界全体がフリーのルートと言ってるけど、で、チッピングだよね、これね。
と言われますよね。
ね、はい、で、で、レイジャーディンがチッピングして登ったじゃないですか。で、それを追放しといて、後でみんなでフリーで登れたから、フリーって言ってるのは、 やっぱ考えるとそれは違うって、ね、そこはやっぱり、ね、欺瞞をちゃんとね、あの自分らで浄化しないとやっぱりまずいと思います。
Layered and the chain. So this he claimed it is not the free climbing.
Well, I think it is now. It is free climbing now. But yeah, and again, you know, like even the nose, the reason it goes free is because people use these pitons, and that what was once just nothing, a big crack like that, now has a tiny finger hole. So it goes free because these were used for 20 years and it made little pockets, you know. So, you know, free climbing is a higher form, but I think efficiency and what happens in the mountains is really the ultimate test. So I heard you talking about Skinner's route and
I mean,
you know, many of them are a bit in Triangle, much more impressive, you know, 40 days. Climbing much more impressive than just what the cowboys did when they, you know, pre-climbed it, but they did it, you know, it took them more time and more aid actually. In the end, they did pre-climb, you know, actually this adventure would be, Nadia Murrah's adventure was much, I think, more human spirit of the challenge, more so, I think, you know, than just what the Americans did.
Yeah. 先ほどあの自分が少し訳したところでもあのジョブに言ってくれてたんですけれども、そのまあフリークライミングに登るっていうことには当然そのムーブを解決しなければいけないとかっていうことでいろんな時間がかかりますよね。でも山だったらどうなんだろうっていうことを彼は言ってるんですよ。それが例えばトランゴのような非常に厳しい気象の中であったら、それに費やしている時間はないかもしれない。そういった時に彼の中でのエフィシエンス、効率っていう話がどんどん重要になってくるわけなんですよ。で、これはあの打ち合わせの時にも彼が繰り返し言ってたことですけれども、トランゴのことで言えば南浦さんが、ソロであのトランゴの岩を登られてますよね。で、それとさっき話に出てきたトッド・スキナー、ポール・ピアノ、アメリカに行ってやるが、フリークライミングでそれを登ろうとしてロープを張って何度も練習して取り組んでいた。どっちの方が、まあ、その冒険としてクライミングとして優れているかというふうに考えたときに、ジョンは僕にとっては南浦のクライミングの方が素晴らしく感じたというふうに言ってました。出ましたよ。
いやい
やいや。Maybe someday, because people are getting better at climbing, they can climb this at 5'16", 5'17", you know, without practice. And if that happens, that would be the highest form. Like, so when I see somebody climb that, it would be like climbing this wall, you know, that would be, you know, that it probably would go free. You know, these would probably go free because the rock is very featured. But it would be the kind of free climbing where you'd have to practice and practice. Someday, climbers may be so good they can just free climb all this. Who knows? You know, they might be. That would be the higher form, I guess. You know, if people. Yeah. You know, just going from the bottom without using aid at all, without practicing the moves. You know.
例えばこの実際に登ったそのグランドボヤージュっていうとこちら側の部分は、まあ、もしかしたらいつの日かクライマーが進歩して、まあ、5、16なのか17なのかそれは分からないけれども、フリークライミングに登れる日が来るかもしれないっていうんです。それは彼の中ではフリークライミングっていうことなので、当然一切の練習なしで下から頂上まで一回で通して登ることができるかもしれない。そうなったらそれはまた別次元のものというふうに言っています。
That makes
sense. こう同じルートを登るにしても、まあ、東堂のスタイルと、まあ、南浦さんのスタイルがあって、どっちがいいか、どっちが悪いかっていうのは
非常に難しい議論だとは思うんですね。でも逆に言うと、一つのものの考え方に固まらない方がいいかもしれない。それで二つのオプションがあるということで、どちらをその時では取るべきなのか、あるいは自分はどっちを取りたいのか、でも別の取り方もあるし、別な登り方もあるということをちょっと頭の隅に入れておいていただきたいなとは思います。
There are two choices to climb the big wall. One is Paul Skinner, the other is Miura. So completely different approach. However, we cannot say this is the better, no, this is the best.
Yeah.
But like you said, in the future, someone can climb just from the bottom to the top without any gear or just free climbing on site.
Yeah.
Boom.
That would be the highest
point. Yeah. It's a great, great. So there's some potential in the future. So we cannot insist just efficiency or I want to pre-plan.
Yeah.
Try hard.
Yeah.
So we should have two eyes or two perspective. One is pushing pre-climb, the other is pushing A5 technique and efficiency or style or speed. So climbing is versatile. And many different way of thinking or many different ideas. So we want to be free and more bold, we hope, and more creative.
Yeah.
So it's our goal.
Yeah. I mean, big wall free climbing is sort of the beginning, I think. You know, when people, like, someday somebody's going to be able to climb Dong Wall, like Adam Andre, you know, he did it very quickly.
Oh, yeah.
Only 7 or 8 days. So, you know.
In the future, yeah.
Well, he did the second ascent. And, you know, but he still had to, like, use a lot of aid to practice. But, you know, someday that route will be done with no aid. And that's. So the first people who pushed the free climbing are very important. Hotskinner and Tommy Caldwell, you know, they're, but in the future, maybe somebody will climb even more as a piece of art. You know, it's really about the experience for what you want to have.
今話していたのはドンウォールのフリークライミングですね。アダム・オンドラが当分採用されることはないだろうと思われたドンウォールを、まあ、ほとんど初めてのビッグウォール経験で登ってしまったという話がありましたよね。でも彼に言わせると、まあ、アマ・アダムですらも、まあ、何度も練習をしているエイドに頼っている。ただいつの日かそれもなくドーンウォールを登るクライマーが未来に現れるかもしれない。そういうふうに考えるとやっぱり一番最初に壁を例えばどれだけ時間をかけて練習をしていたとしてもフリーで登ろうっていうふうに突き詰めていったトミー・コールドウェルの功績は偉大だとっていうふうに話しています。
他の質問、
はい、では他の質問ももしよろしければ。
今日はどうもありがとうございます。ちょっと、話の方向が変わっちゃうかもしれないんですけど、僕が今日面白いなと思った 動画の一つにオープンソースっていうことを言われていて、それでD4 のポータルエッジ の設計図をジョンさんのウェブサイトで、まあ、手書きのものもたくさんあって、公開されたりしているので
。In your presentation is about the open source of D4 portal edge. So you made it the sketch or how to make that thing as an open source. Anybody can use that, right? So, but he pointed out maybe.Perhaps you make a lot more money instead of make it open source.
Oh, money.
Does it make this?
Well,
you did make it open source.
Yeah.
Let anyone use that.
Yeah.
But if only you make it just a private thing,
you
could make more money.
Well, here's the number one thing. If you want to make money,Don't make portal edges.
So he wants to ask you, is it from some kind of boundary thoughts you have? Or, so what is the reason you made it an open source?
Well, I guess that goes back a lot because I made a lot of new ideas andI think ultimately it comes down to this. I think if you want to be creative and keep being creative. If you are trying to protect your idea, like, oh, this is my idea, then you can't be creative for the next thing, you know? So I think it's just like creative, put it out there, and, you know, I think just share the idea. You know, that's always been my idea. It's like, help.You share it, and maybe if you want to make money, become a businessman, a teacher, or you know, something where it's. My experience with making climbing gear is that I wasn't able to leverage it like Yvon Chouinard, or that wasn't. I didn't have the brain, so it's like, okay, well, I'll share my idea. So, I think a good businessman maybe can, you know, make a brand and do all that, but for me it was it's more fun to share than to try to protect.
結構分かっていただけたような気がしますけど、まず彼は、まあ、とにかくそのクリエイティブでいたいんだということを願っているそうです。で、そのクリエイティブにいるためにどうするか。まあ、とにかくクリエイティブで位置づけるためにそれをオープンにしている。その例えばその何か一つ新しいことを開発したとして、それを作り方を秘密にしていたら次のアイデアが浮かんでこないというのが彼の心情なんですよね。なので作ったものはできるだけシェアをして、自分はより新しいアイデアを出すというのがこの心構えだというふうに言っています。
Do you want to make part of this?Yeah, please. I would make me happy to see the design, you know, that climbers would use it.
その会社を起こして、例えばそのビジネスをしていくビジネスマンの考え方としては間違っているかもしれないけれども、僕はどちらかというとシェアする方が楽しかったから
というふうに言っていました。だから10年ぐらい前にですね、オスプレイっていうパックの、まあオーナーでデザイナーだった人がやっぱり似たようなこと言ってまして、でこれすごい発明だな、パテント取ったのかって私が聞いたら、いやパテントなんてのは必要ないよで、だって真似されたらすぐまた偽物みたいなのがすぐ出てくるじゃないかっつったら、その時はまた違うものをもう先に進めればいいんだと。で、後から来る人は何回も真似したいだけしていけばいいんで、自分が常に新しいものを作り出して出れば何もそんなことする必要ないと言われて、なんか、あ、なるほどね、やっぱりすごい人はすごいなと思いましたけど、まあ、ジョーも似たようなですね。
Thank you for that.
しようかと思いますが、はい。
ジョンさんがヨセミテで一番好きなルートっていうのを教えていただけないでしょうか。単純な質問ですいません。あと理由も知りたいです。はい、
So he asked you, what is your favorite route in Yosemite and what and why?
Yeah, I think that easy. Two in the nose in one day. My favorite day of all climbing is doing the nose in one day. You know, it's the best day of climbing ever. So, you know, but I use you know mostly free climbing and a little bit of aid and.Run fast, so yeah.
Excuse me.
Maybe a mile climbing in 10 hours, yeah.
You made a two-timer.
Yeah.
Using 15 meters rope.
Yeah.
And a 16 meters rope.
Yeah.
Which is one.
You know, yeah. 1,000 meters.
彼の答えはノーズ。で、それをワンデーで登ったとき。ノーズインアで略してニアットっていうふうに。よくクライマーも言うようですけれども、それが一番、あれが今までのクライミング人生の中で最高の一日だったというふうに思います。坂下さんからちょっとツッコミが入ったのは、その2回やってるんですよ、ジョンは。50メートルのロープを使って何ピッチで登ったっていうのと、60メートルのロープを使ってもうちょっとピッチ数を減らして登ったっていうときなんで、どっちが良かったんだっていうふうにちょっとツッコんだ質問をしていました。はい。では、そろそろ名残惜しいですけれども、もっと聞きたいこといっぱいあるんですけどね、イベントの方を閉じていきたいかと思います。坂下さんの方から何か総括いただければと思います。
ああ、大体、このミーティングの中でいろんな話をしたと思います。それで、まあ、総括っていうのは特にないんですけど、まあ、ジョンがまずここに来てくれたことに感謝して、もう一回彼に盛大な拍手を送ります。
Thank you.